Good evening. Thank you for being back so promptly with your drinks. I'm also glad that the AC decided to cool down in time for the conversation that's going to heat things up. Jyotirmay Sharma is a polymath. He is a political scientist, he's a political philosopher, he's a public intellectual, he is an intellectual historian. If I made up three new disciplines tonight, by the time I finished speaking, he would have mastered them. He knows, I think, 11 languages, amongst them three of probably the most difficult languages to learn in the world, classical languages, Sanskrit, Greek, Latin, but also Pali, Tamil, I think, Marathi, Hindi, Urdu. That is all one life's work, but it is not just to master the language, it is to make sure that the scholarship that he has produced as an outcome has been the most rigorous and sustained of its kind in the country. I mentioned earlier, Jyotirmay has devoted virtually two decades to the study of Hinduism, the intellectual history of Hinduism, and a quartet of very, very critically acclaimed books have emerged from this study. That is the most rigorous, cross-generational, I think covering two centuries, if not more, of Hindu thought. We're going to start, the starting point of this conversation is from the most recent of those books, which is, of course, about a restatement of religion. It's Swami Vivekananda and the making of the Hindu nationalist movement. But this is a really sustained examination of Hinduism, its relevance, and its really, really brutal schisms today. It is my privilege to invite on stage Jyotirmay Sharma.
Thank you, Payal, for this overwhelmingly generous introduction. I often feel that the whole evening should just consist of this. Why would you want to hear me after this?
Because I want to.
That's kind.
So, we'll start, Jyotir, from, we call this conversation Beyond the Gods, the Hinduism that matters. Is there a Hinduism that matters? And equally crucially, should it matter?
That's a hugely interesting question because, I mean, imagine, imagine an evening of this sort with this crowd, which is highly intelligent, clued, curious, sitting in the 18th century, and a hot, horribly sultry, oppressive evening as Chennai gives you at this point of time in the year, would you be discussing Hinduism that matters? You would be discussing metaphysical issues, if you were clued into them, you would be discussing war and peace, profit and loss, love and love having disappeared, deceit, jealousy. I don't know how many other emotions, values, virtues we would be discussing, but would we be discussing Hinduism that matters? And I think there lies a problem. And the problem is this, the moment you start saying the Hinduism that matters, you have to ask the question, matters to whom? Why should it matter? If it matters, what's the big deal about it? And I think aligned with this is that old chestnut which we have been living with for just 100 years, mind you. If you again went to my favorite 18th century and said, Hinduism is a way of life, nobody would understand you. You know, they would say, what does it mean? There would be a Vaishnava way of life, there would be a Shaivite way of life, there would be a Shakta way of life. There would be innumerable other ways of life. But nobody would understand you when you say Hinduism is a way of life. What this means is, and what you've asked me is a profoundly important political question. When you say Hinduism is a way of life, it means you must ask the political question, whose way of life? And that whose way of life carries within itself questions of power, domination, violence, and so on and so forth. Because if I were to say if people often say to me, but isn't the answer to this question, each Hindu decides what his way of life is? And my answer to it is brilliant. Yes, we do decide. But will we be allowed to live that way of life without somebody coming and saying, "Arey, ye mat karo, wo mat karo, don't do this, don't do that."
That's not the right way to be a Hindu.
That's not the right way to be a Hindu. This is the right way. Similarly, with this question that you asked, a profoundly political question, does Hinduism matter? Matter to whom? See, I when she said Tamil, that I knew Tamil, I was deeply embarrassed because my Tamil is the stuff that, you know, it can generate a few laughs. But I have, I'm 1/4 genetically Tamil. My grandmother came from Tanjore. Surgeon, one of the first students in CMC Vellore, Radhika mentioned earlier, CMC Vellore, my grandmother had actually seen Idaskader. Here was a surgeon who all her life, except for the last 1 year of her life when she was critically ill, got up at 3:30 in the morning, did her puja in a wet sari, made our lives miserable by creating noise when we wanted to sleep. But I never heard her in the 33 years that I had known her tell somebody this was a way of life or this is what was relevant. You must do this in order for your soul to be emancipated or your Atman to be becoming one with Brahman and so on and so forth. It was deeply personal. And it is relevant in the sense that a lot of us respond to what we today in a shrunken, emaciated sense know as Hinduism. We get so much from it in different ways. As long as it doesn't cross the threshold where we try to tell our neighbor, this is the right way. The moment we start that, then it's a political enterprise. It's not religion, it's not faith, it's not spirituality.
So, Jyotir, you said matters to whom. I'd like to ask, why did it matter to you? And at what stage did you decide that this framework, you know, the belief of Hinduism as a tolerant, as a peace-loving, as a self-reflective, non-materialistic way of life was something you wanted to examine? And what did that examination lead you to?
My going into this came from two different sources. One was an accidental, the word accidental itself is these days compromised. An accidental, you know how our grandparents and parents were at one point of time. They never asked you, do you want to do this or do you want to do that? They just told you, you must do this. So this Tanjore grandmother of mine said, you must learn Sanskrit. And the man that I got who taught me Sanskrit was an amazing man. He was an amazing man. He did not commit the folly of starting with grammar. He said, son, I still remember him saying to me, beta, we will recite for 2 years. If you can't love the cadences and the musicality of the language, then the language will forever be lost to you. And so we recited for 2 years. And then I started getting a sense of the texts. Now, nobody, no civilization could ever make the claim that everything in their texts, in their literature, is wonderful. I think all civilizations are a mixture of the pure and the tainted. And an admission of the fact that every civilization has elements which are sublime, but also compromised, also tainted, gives strength to that civilization. Not admitting it makes us fundamentalists, makes us insecure. And so the first reason why I came to it was that I had some sense of these texts. What were they saying? It wasn't it didn't tally with what I was being increasingly told this entity called Hinduism is. And of course, the second was a purely political reaction to what was happening in the country from the Shilanyas and the Ram Janmabhoomi movement onwards. And, you know, one wanted to say, look, you know, this is not what I know. And I'm not even saying what I know is the last word or is definitive. But there are possibilities that you could explore even within your formulation of what you think is Hinduism. And I came to realize that there is a simple thing happening in the 19th century, and we are still paying for it. So the 21st century, to my mind, is the long 19th century. How is it the long 19th century? I mean, imagine yourself in the 19th century, any one of you, or, you know, any one of you. Here you are, you have developed a sense of the fact that you're being ruled by the British. And you want to rule yourselves, you want your fate to be determined by yourselves. So there comes in a philosophy or an idea called nationalism. In the colonial context, greatly emancipatory, in terms of unleashing forces of certain kinds, extremely toxic. So a mixed blessing. Now, the 19th century idea that in India that was received, uniformly received, was, if one were to crudely summarize, a nation consisted of, apart from a population and a territory, etc., etc., a nation consisted of what they called a core or a center. Every nation must have a core. Every nation must have a center. The European nations that we were emulating declared that this was the core of our nation and that was the core of our nation. So the Indians had to find a core. They found that core in what they called religion, which was coterminous with religion stroke spirituality and so on and so forth. Now, if religion and spirituality was the core, then you had to obviously define which religion, because India had many religions. It had many faiths. So there enters the majoritarian principle. We are still debating that principle and suffering from that principle. But there was two other crucial things to be done in the 19th century. Having declared that religion was the center of the national existence, you had to determine not merely for religion, but for everything that was quote-unquote indigenous, Indian. How much of that will you take in defining the nation? Will you take sati as part of the nation? No, we will not take sati as part of the nation. Will you take marrying prepubescent young girls at an early age as part of the nation? No, of course not. Will you take an inherent violence that's there in the hierarchical caste system? No, of course no. These are aberrations. So a process started in the 19th century, selectively saying, this constitutes true India. How much of the West will you take? That was another question. So there again began this process of selectively saying, oh, we don't like the materialism of the West, but we like something else of the West. We don't like this of the West. And what was created in the end in the 19th century was a very uneasy hodgepodge, because it excluded more than it included. It had to fit into a very truncated, limiting notion of what constitutes the nation. That's where the problem begins.
So Jyotir, you've said this was done, but you have so far not said who was at the heart of this enterprise. And as far as your book is concerned, you lay the process squarely at Swami Vivekananda's door. Do you, and that's why I think the book is called A Restatement of Religion, which is, it took what existed before, it sifted, as you've just described, and came up with the new unspoken tenets. There are two parts to this question. First, what was the purpose of this exercise, not just looking outward at the West, but internally? And equally crucially, what did we lose in the process? What of the classical Hinduism? Was there a classical Hinduism prior to that that could be defined as such? And what did we lose of that?
These are difficult three questions. Very difficult three questions.
I will keep quiet for the rest of the evening.
No, I can't match Radhika in any way except that I can out-talk her. Your last question, is there something called classical Hinduism? That itself is a political question. Because after all, people who wield power socially, spiritually, decide what the canon is. My book is better than yours, your book is better than mine. If you go before this 19th century construct of this entity called Hinduism, I read out to my students once in a while various Puranas, where the Linga Purana says anyone who doesn't worship Shiva, his eyes should be taken out, his hands should be cut, and his tongue should be slashed. And this is even before Saudi Arabia started doing this many centuries ago. You find these things in text after text. The danger there is, and this is a real danger to say, no. The Puranas are not spiritual, they're aberrations. Let's go to the Upanishads. But the Upanishads also has the story of Jabala and Satyakam. There's also the story of Gautama not being able to answer the questions of a king, at which point the king offers money and various things, to which Gautama says, no, I have enough money and I have enough young girls to give me pleasure. The Upanishads have them. Where will you stop? I think this whole idea of a disinterested classicism, classicism which has nothing to do with our present day problems, is at the root of the issue. Because we don't understand that classicism, the beauty of Jabala and Satyakam's story. We don't understand what Gautama was up to. We do not understand several of those in their context. We don't know the language. I remember when I was writing my book on Golwalkar and the RSS, I went to Nagpur and I met a former Sarsang Chalak of the RSS for an interview. And he says, but what is your problem? Didn't we thousands of years ago, please also note how imprecise we are about everything in our lives. When was this temple built? Oh, thousands of years ago. It could have been 400 years ago. Thousands of years ago. When was this written? Thousands of years ago. So he said to me, wasn't it said thousands of years ago that we are immortality's children? Didn't we declare to the world that we are immortality's children? Sunvantu Vishve Amritasya Putraha. Now the word Vishve in Vedic Sanskrit means interlocutors. You are my Vishva, literally. The Vishve, my interlocutors, people who are sitting in front of me, listening to me. This complete break from a tradition and the disciplines that went, and I'm using the plural, the disciplines that went into this whole process has given us this truncated understanding of who we are. There is a word which I'm hesitant to use, but I will use it nonetheless. You asked me about Vivekananda. I could go on about Vivekananda. I could go on about Ramakrishna, who I admire enormously. But look at the process by which something is happening with Vivekananda. First proposition. Who is the greatest Vedantin of all times? Vivekananda asks the question. He answers it. Ramakrishna. Who is the greatest scientist of all times? He answers the question. Ramakrishna. Why? Because he asked, he always said, never believe anything before you have interrogated it fully. Always ask, why is it so? What is this? What is this? Number three, if Ramakrishna is the greatest scientist, and if Ramakrishna is the greatest Vedantin, then Hinduism must have a pure, unadulterated core. What is that core? Vedanta. So if Vedanta, Ramakrishna is the greatest Vedantin and the greatest scientist, and if Vedanta is the core of Hinduism, then Hinduism is scientific. This process took away from Hinduism. It's a Western process. Vivekananda got it from the West. Let's not pretend. He got it purely from the West. It's a process by which people in the 19th century were trying to make religion scientific. We didn't need to make religion scientific. In the process of making religion scientific, it lost color, it lost texture, it lost dance, it lost song, it lost joy. We made it into a self-serving instrument of domination. I'm not suggesting at any given point of time that there were no conflicts before the 19th century. But Payal would be familiar with my favorite phrase there. She has to suffer listening to me over and over again in different cities.
I'm only getting started and I can keep at it in every city in the country.
I think so, thank you. There is something called a gentle rubbing against each other. We must fight. We must have disagreements. What is a society? What is a country? What is a people who do not have fights, who do not have disagreements? But of course we must have conflicts. As long as those conflicts don't end in genocide, as long as that conflict doesn't end in we killing each other. That's all. People had conflicts. Before the 19th century, people had conflicts. People had disagreements. But they didn't kill each other. Why didn't they kill each other? A tentative answer. All my answers are tentative. Lovely escape route, which I learned from Hinduism. We lost the joy we had in what is the greatest damage that this making Hinduism scientific did to us. It said Hinduism has two parts. You read any 19th century text by Vivekananda, anybody, till the 20th century. Read anyone. Hinduism, the real Hinduism lies in the non-ritualistic Hinduism. The more obscure metaphysical Hinduism. Why? Exactly. Ritual creates a space. I hate my brother. I detest my sister. I don't have a brother, so no eyebrows need be raised. But as an example, I hate my brother. I have a sister who I love to distraction. But let's suppose I hate my sister, I hate my brother, and then we gather together annually for our parents' Shraddha. No, you call it ritual. Of course, the spirits don't eat the food that you offer to them, but it's wonderful food. It's brilliant food, and you meet. The ritual has created a space for three antagonistic people to gather together, which they normally won't. Now, I've given you the most mundane example. So all ritual is not bad. Just as all metaphysics is not lofty. And we got caught in that whole business of saying, oh, make it scientific. By the way, Ramakrishna, when he said, examine everything, he did not mean what Vivekananda misrepresented it as. Ramakrishna said, examine everything. Don't believe anything. But when you examine it through love eyes, prema chakshu. Something he gets from Vaishnava Bhakti of the Chaitanya variety. It's not this crude scientific looking under a microscope. Look at everything, look at the world with love eyes, he says. If you look at it with bare eyes of the scientist, you will not find anything. That's what Ramakrishna says. He's a great hero. He's a wonderful man.
So what part of Ramakrishna's Hinduism did Vivekananda most alter?
Everything.
So for you mentioned, for example, you said that Ramakrishna was more, he was a mystic. And he believed in the mystical aspects.
He was an Advaitin. He believed in Dvaita. He was a tantric. He believed in bhakti.
He was a Kali devotee.
He was a Shakta. He lived as a Muslim for 6 months. He lived as a Christian for 6 months. He wanted to experience the Dasa Bhava within Vaishnava devotionalism. Tied a tail to his back, made monkey noises and lived up on a tree. When my Vivekananda book was published, one of the anonymous referees, while saying he or she liked the book very much, should be published, said, the Ramakrishna chapter would have been much better had you compared him with a mystic in the south like Ramalinga Swami. And people here are familiar with, the kind of mysticism of a Ramalinga Swami. So I don't see anything except the claim that he puts his hand on Vivekananda's head and everything is imbibed. That's a different story. The beauty of Ramakrishna and Vivekananda side by side is very valuable to us in the 21st century and today. And it simply tells us that two or more models of what you understand as Hinduism can coexist side by side. You simply don't have to have one model. That's all.
So on that note, you have said, and that's a very radical statement, that you don't distinguish between Hindutva and Hinduism, or that Hinduism is just a modern face or the most contemporary, maybe political face, of the same impulse. Why do you say so? What do you mean by that?
It's very easy to say something is an aberration. My gray hair and my weight is an aberration of what I was 20 years ago. So today I'm not that real, authentic Jyotirmay Sharma as I was 20 years ago when I was tall, dark and handsome. It doesn't work. You have to own it, be responsible for it and say, many elements within Hindutva partake of this large entity we call Hinduism, which had brutal violence in it and had sublime metaphysics in it. Today, Hindutva is the politically dominant, my definition in the book is the politically dominant face of Hinduism, though not the only face.
I have a question.
When we finish?
So it's basically that. You have to say it's part of that continuum. Otherwise, you get into this whole business of a fall. And we love this story, golden age, fall, and then we'll wait for an avatar who comes with 56 inches or whatever to redeem us. That's frightening. I don't think we should wait for avatars. We are all those avatars who can transform whatever we need to transform, as long as we have confidence in the fact that we don't have to look at a disinterested past. Our best was not in the past. Our best is we today and in the future.
Jyotir, that's okay. So my question really here then is, what is the face of, because part of the creation of the Hindu identity is to conflate it with the idea of a national identity. What nationalism can exist outside, or is there a nationalism that can exist outside of Hinduism?
Yeah, it exists in so many countries which even have a formal religion as the state religion.
So what's the way to get there?
What's the way to get there? Respect the constitution. I mean, we're ready to hug and kiss mediocre stuff produced by modern day babas. Why is it so difficult to kiss and hug the Indian constitution? In defamation case in Warangal, my favorite story, you'll never escape from this story. In Warangal, defamation case against me, I go to the court and they bring Bhagavad Gita in front of me and say, put your hand on this. I say, no Bhagavad Gita, I want the Indian constitution. The court doesn't have a copy of the Indian constitution. The proceedings are adjourned. 6 months later, and I'm not joking, 6 months later, they get a copy, they call me and say, sir, it's Durga Das Basu's pass notes, but please live with it. Otherwise, we'll have to postpone this again. A court in this country doesn't have a copy of the constitution. I'm not saying the constitution is perfect. I'm the last person to say the constitution is perfect, but we made it. Not some disinterested past about which we know nothing, or we know little, or what we know is deeply flawed. We know that this conversation ideally should have been this evening, not Hinduism that matters, but poverty that matters, filth that matters, oppression that matters. No. If you say poverty today, you're a Naxalite. You say rule of law, you are a pseudo-liberal. No, I think there has to be a deep soul searching as to why do we look at the past so much? We look at the past. I'm not saying don't look at the past. There are wonderful things in the past. I recently translated, Payal knows about this. I've translated a 14th, 15th century. We really don't know the exact date. One can speculate, as with many ancient texts. A political satire. It has a fascinating history because the manuscript that comes to us is written by somebody called Vishveshwar Bhattacharya. It's a political satire written by Vishveshwar Bhattacharya, but it was the first Sanskrit text to be translated into Braj Bhasha. But we also know from internal evidence that it was performed in the court of a Telangana king. And the names are different. So there is a Premarup and a Kamarup who is supposed to have written this text. You read this text, there is nothing in that text which is different from our contemporary world. Nothing. King is compromised. Subjects are compromised. Brahmins have fallen on evil ways. Nobody does things the way it should be done. Dharma has derailed. Law has fled out of fear of various things and so on and so forth. What's different? Why can't we write a political satire of our times in democratic India without one being beheaded or jailed or whatever else it is? I think there is a problem in, you know, looking forward to the past a bit too much.
So, Jyotir, if you were to, and I have a few questions about actually Hinduism and its intersections with multiple other aspects of contemporary life. But first, if you were to critique Hinduism as you understand it, where is the most intense self-reflection required?
I wouldn't critique Hinduism at all, because it's a useless exercise. It's an artificial creation. One can criticize if one is serious, if one is not rhetorical and one is not, looking for, you know, cheap rhetorical points. Concepts, categories. Is there an idea of freedom in Hinduism if one doesn't go the moksha or the Jivan Mukti way? Is there an idea of freedom which is not imported from the West? So freedom from and freedom to. Is there an indigenous notion of freedom? Very difficult to answer that question. What about equality? Can a caste society have equality? And if it has equality, what kind of equality would we have? We had that wonderful conversation in Hyderabad with Aishwari Kumar the other day. He talked about this so eloquently. I'm interested in ideas. I'm not interested in abstract notions which do nothing to me in either an aesthetic way or an intellectual way.
So I want to come to caste. Is caste an idea? And is there any merit in the idea of caste?
We need to cast it aside.
But it's a crucial question when discussing.
No, I think if, let's say, roll back the tape. Your first question. Does Hinduism matter? If I were to start answering it in an Ambedkarite way, the whole conversation would be one word and one syllable. No. I think that voice has to be taken seriously. I think before the 19th century, we lived, whoever we were, Vaishnavites, Shaivites, Shaktas, whatever. We lived uncomfortably, not happily, uncomfortably with the idea that there are people who have a non-transcendental idea of God. A non-transcendental idea of divinity. And that, I think, is the beginning of understanding the whole question of caste.
But you don't want to go further.
May not be today.
Okay. You've studied...
Because it'll unravel.
Fair enough. But you've studied the genealogy of Hinduism, and as part of that, have you found Hinduism inflected in any way by Islam, for example?
Of course.
In what ways?
The Bhakti period. I don't... Let me answer the previous question. I think it needs to be answered.
I think we've arrived at a good model of questioning.
Since you are the bell ringer and you are here, so there's nobody to ring the bell either.
No. I think, in other words, you realize you're being held hostage.
This self-consciousness about taking from others, borrowing. You don't mind borrowing sugar from the neighbor, curd from the neighbor. Ideas, there's some problem. When a poet, Kabir's time, Kumar Gandhar sang it so beautifully, sings, Ao Kalandar Keshava, Kalandar Keshava. If you don't understand the beauty of it, you and I wouldn't be spending an evening together, is all I say. I'm not going to say your soul is irredeemably lost. I'm not going to say you'll fry in the most horrid hell, because then I'll be replicating what the modern day proponents of one way will tell you. You can't appreciate the beauty of that. It would be sad. And we have done this systematically to poetry and literature of all sorts. Look at what we have done to Annamaya. You know, I love MS singing the Annamacharya Kritis, but the Kritis chosen are so sanitized. All the erotic Kritis are, no, don't go that way. You mustn't touch those. Because we are scared. Annamacharya wasn't scared. You are scared of your sexuality. You are scared of what Annamacharya might teach you. It's happened to Ramprasad Sen in Bengal. It's happened all over. The Baudelaireization of the richness of literature in this country, of poetry, of music. When I tell my students, Annamacharya wrote this, Telugu land, I live in Hyderabad, I say, Annamacharya wrote this, and he wasn't stupid. His faith was not flimsy like ours. He's talking to the God of seven hills, and he can express that only in terms of eroticism. Now the answer to this will be, oh, but it's all symbolic. But how can eroticism be symbolic? Now, I have all the answers to the questions people say, ah, but Annamacharya ka to symbolic tha. It was all symbolic. What is symbolic about breasts and orgasms? I don't understand. I mean, it's funny.
You and Radhika Apte both.
We share the same birthday.
You share the same birthday, absolutely. Jyotir, you said Islam. How did colonialism inflect Hinduism? Was there a different Hinduism pre-colonialism and post?
Oh, it did. It affected it very, very, very much. It affected it in terms of our own texts being discovered by the Indologists, bad translations, terrible understanding of them, interpretations which we took seriously. The Pune Brahmins even had piles of Max Müller's texts which they prayed ritually to, put flowers and incense, and called him Moksha Mula. You know, all sorts of funny things happen. But that's where what modern social scientists say happens when there is an asymmetry between knowledge and power.
Okay.
There's always somebody who will ring the bell.
There is always
ask
someone.
Not for whom the bell tolls.
So, is there, and we started to talk about Hindutva, what is the face of Hinduism that you see? Is there a way this current muscular, almost aggressive form of Hinduism can recede to allow room for another?
What a lovely question. It can recede only through an excess of culture. Culture is a bad word these days. Give them more song, more dance of all kinds. Don't say classical dance again. I'm sorry to say this in Chennai. But go beyond the Madras Music Academy and what it does. It does wonderful stuff, but, you know, a little more culture. Great literature, great art, great music. You'll have resistance. They'll resist it. Because the one thing that they are scared of is thought. What is the great strength of any fundamentalist ideology? Extreme ideology, information. Information, excess of information. Excess of information is the death of thought. And they represent the death of thought. culture. This city has produced, you know, civilizational cultural icons. Sometimes they're outspoken also, like T.M. Krishna. Cherish them, celebrate them. Listen to their music with an open mind. That's how you will fight it. You can't fight it through ideology or counter-ideology or nothing. Nothing can defeat this in the next 500 years. I'll be dead and gone sooner than you imagine. But this can only be fought. Why this? Anything else which tells you there is only one way, one monochromatic, single way of doing things, can only be fought with an excess of celebration of culture.
And I have a final question, Jyotir, which is, have we therefore somewhere fundamentally lost the spirit of religion? And is that loss unique to Hinduism? Or is this now the nature of religion globally?
Seriously answering this question, there must be 200 people in this room, of which I am certain almost all of them, or most of them, have some sense of religion which is non-threatening, non-antagonistic. So is Hinduism lost? No, it's not lost. It's lost somewhere else. And there is no recognition of that.
And the reclaiming is through culture.
Reclaiming is through culture.
On that note, there can't be a better note for an Arts and Ideas Club to end on. We hope we can all be part of the reclaiming of culture. Jyotir, thank you. This is a privilege. Thank you very much.